There's a bit of a controversial movie that's out right now. It just came out on, I believe it was March 3rd or 2nd. Anyways, this week, Debbie and I went to see it. How many of you have heard about the movie called The Shack? Anyone? Okay, some of you. Okay, so there's a lot of different opinions about that. The good news I found out, Debbie said she read the book and the book was bloodier than the movie. I think that's good news. The Shack... in it, a young man who's had a pretty tough childhood. In fact, his dad was so abusive of him and his mom that this young man actually poisoned his father, put strychnine in his alcohol, and killed him. Years later, the movie picks up with the story of this young man and his children. They actually go to a lake, and while at the lake, an accident occurs, and the young man, Mac is his name, Mac swims out to try to rescue his children, one of whom is underneath a canoe that's tipped over. The daughter's screaming. The little daughter's left back at the picnic table by the tent. They rescue the little boy, give him mouth-to-mouth resuscitation. He's able to breathe again and survives. Mac turns around to go back to the campsite to his little daughter and can't find her. A search begins, and sadly, the sheriffs and all come to him and say, there is a man in the area that's been molesting children. We've been searching for him for 5 years, and we're afraid he may have taken her. And sadly, that he had taken her to an old shack, and Mac finds this old shack, and they show him the bloody dress of his little daughter and blood all over the floor. He knows that she's been killed. As you can imagine, Mac moves into some pretty deep depression and grief, some real intense heartache, and some anger towards God. The little girl used to refer to God as Papa. And so when they would pray together, they would pray to Papa. One day, a note shows up totally out of the blue, during a snowstorm. A note shows up in the mailbox, and the note is written on an old typewriter, and it just says, meet me at the shack. It's been a long time since we've talked. Papa. Sounds rather crazy. Mac isn't sure what it is. Finally, he decides to go to the shack, the place where his daughter had been murdered. Yeah, you can probably imagine he is angry with God, and he takes a gun with him, and he's hoping to find the guy because he thinks this is from the guy that molested and killed his daughter. Well, let me read to you what some of the scripts about this say. Mac Phillips spirals into a deep depression, causing him to question his innermost beings. Facing a crisis of faith, he receives a mysterious letter urging him to an abandoned shack deep in the Oregon wilderness. The shack is where the bloody dress of his little daughter was found. Despite his doubts, Mac journeys to the shack and encounters an enigmatic trio of strangers. In other texts reading about this, they call them the Trinity. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Here's where people get upset. Despite his doubt, this Trinity is led by a woman named Papa. A woman named Papa. Through this meeting, Mac finds important truths that will transform his understanding of his tragedy and change his life forever. Joel Houston from Hillsong United, a real man of God, says, perhaps the most profound description of God, of who God is, how he works, and what faith and life is about ever put into a film. Deeply moving and inspiring. Outreach Marketing says, rather than attempting to provide a thorough theological explanation of the Trinity, the movie seeks to offer a descriptive understanding of the Trinity through the experience of the main character, Mac. Mac struggles spiritually because of trauma he endured as a child at the hands of his earthly father and an incredibly painful and heartbreaking tragedy he faced as an adult. The treatment of the Trinity reflects the idea that God is graciously meeting Mac where he is, entering into his pain and doubt in a manner that helps him to process his pain and find healing and wholeness in a relationship with God. Again, this is a work of fiction and is meant to portray some of the many complex and beautiful aspects of God. One of the interesting aspects of the movie for me, and why I'm mentioning it today, because some of you are like, oh, that sounds like heresy. They're presenting people that look like God. There's this, and there's three different characters, and then God actually comes in two different forms. First, as this loving lady who's fixing food and everything for them, and then later as a father. An older dad, still not with a white beard like Mac expected. But however you think about that, God is Trinity, and it's hard to imagine and picture that. But what hit me the most on this movie was that Mac, as he's struggling with his pain, God says, here, sit on the throne. Yeah, where you judge people. No, Mac, where you can judge now. And Mac actually sits down on this rock chair and has to admit that throughout most of his life, he has been judging God. In fact, when you think about that, don't we judge God? Isn't a judgment of God to say God is loving, God is forgiving, God is kind, God is compassionate, God is caring? Isn't that a judgment of God? See, don't misunderstand what judgment is. Judgment isn't always saying, okay, I condemn you, or you're bad, or whatever. It's making determinations about another person, and in this sense, about God. Well, Mac had reached the point where he judged that God was mean, probably evil, and he really didn't want anything to do with him. In fact, he has this long dialogue with God. Why would you take my little girl? Because if you're really a loving God, you should have been there to rescue her. You should have been there to protect her. You should have been there to save her. You can't be loving if you allowed my little girl to die. The Sanhedrin, or at least a portion of them, as Mark is going to tell us, is going to say, all of the Sanhedrin met. And if all of them met, there would have been 71 of them. Scribes, Pharisees, and Sadducees. Plus the high priest, who would have been the leader, the judge, the main person leading any kind of a trial. All of them gather together at the high priest's house to investigate. Well, that was their job. But what they'd come there to do is to judge Jesus for death. Mark 14, verse 53. They took Jesus to the high priest, and all the chief priests, the elders, and teachers of the law came together. Peter followed him at a distance right into the courtyard of the high priest. There he sat with the guards and warmed himself at the fire. Let me just pause there and say that we're not going to look at Peter tonight, this morning. We're going to look at this, really what I believe is an unholy, illegal trial of Jesus Christ. We'll come back to Peter next week, but just take note, Peter's there. He's already in the courtyard. He's watching and waiting to see what's going to happen to Jesus. Verse 55, the chief priests and the whole Sanhedrin were looking for evidence against Jesus so that they could put him to death, but they did not find any. Pause one more time. It says the whole Sanhedrin. How many of you remember the name Joseph of Arimathea? You ought to remember that name. He's the one who donated his grave for Jesus and went to Pilate, actually asked for the body of Jesus to be able to put in his grave. And the scripture tells us that Joseph of Arimathea was one who believed in Jesus as a member of the Sanhedrin. How many of you remember the name Nicodemus from John chapter 3? Also, another member of the Sanhedrin who comes tonight, and who probably has faith in Jesus. What we need to realize is that even though Scripture will make generalizations like this, probably not all 71 of them were there. And in fact, that very fact alone, that not all 71 there, that makes this an illegal trial. Well, we'll come and get to some more of that. Verse 56. Many testified falsely against him, but their statements did not agree. Then some stood up and gave this false testimony against him. We heard him say, I will destroy this temple made with human hands, and in 3 days will build another not made with hands. Yet even then their testimony did not agree. Then the high priest stood up before them and asked Jesus, are you not going to answer? What is this testimony that these men are bringing against you? But Jesus remained silent and gave no answer. Again the high priest asked, are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed One? And this next declaration is a profound statement which, if anyone ever questions you, did Jesus ever say he was divine? Turn to this very verse. Are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed One? I am, said Jesus. And you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the Mighty One and coming on the clouds of heaven. The high priest tore his clothes. Why do we need any more witnesses? You have heard the blasphemy. What do you think? They all condemned him as worthy of death. Then some began to spit at him. They blindfolded him, struck him with their fists, and said, prophesy! And the guards took him and beat him. May I simply say that nothing about this trial was legal according to Jewish law? It's at the home of Caiaphas, the high priest. Where was the Sanhedrin supposed to meet, all 71 of them? In the temple, or in the temple area, at a place set aside specifically for that purpose. The Sanhedrin meets not for the purpose that they were called to meet, which should have been as judges. They should be hearing from defendant and from plaintiff. They should be hearing both sides and weighing all the evidence, not paying for false testimony. Their responsibility was to judge, not to prosecute. And yet, as we look at this text today, we're going to see that the Sanhedrin is clearly acting as prosecutors. I don't know what you believe about the whole immigration issue in our country right now, but just this week, a judge in Oregon, some of you may have heard this story, is under investigation for allegedly helping an undocumented immigrant escape Immigration and Customs Enforcement officers, ICE officers, who had come to apprehend this man. Multnomah County Judge Monica Horance was notified by court staff that ICE officers were waiting outside her courtroom for Didier Pacheco Salazar, a Mexican national appearing in connection with a DUI charge on January 27th. He had come to plead guilty to the charge in exchange for a suspended sentence contingent upon his entry into a diversion program, according to local media reports. What exactly ensued is not yet determined, but officials in the local U.S. Attorney's Office fear Horantz guided Salazar out of the courtroom through an employee's exit and then out of the building. I felt that it was inappropriate and delegitimizes the work of ICE agents who are out there doing their jobs, U.S. Attorney Billy Williams told local press. When you're talking about the judicial system, whether it's federal or by state, you have an expectation that people are going to abide by the law and not take steps based on their own motivations, their own politics, whatever the motivation was. Let me read that again. When you're talking about the judicial system, whether it's federal or by state, you have an expectation that people are going to abide by the law and not take steps based on their own motivations, their own politics, whatever the motivation was. The chief priests and the whole Sanhedrin were looking for, this is verse 55, were looking for evidence against Jesus so they could put him to death. But they did not find any. William Barclay tells us that the official meeting place of the Sanhedrin was called the Hall of Hewn Stone. It was within the temple precincts, and the decisions of the Sanhedrin were not valid unless reached at a meeting held in that place. Where did I say their meeting? At Caiaphas's house. It's not a legal meeting at all because it's not in the proper location. It's like setting up court here or something like that, or at my house instead of in a courtroom. The court could not meet at night. The court could not meet at night. What time are they meeting? Probably around midnight. By the time Jesus has finished the Passover meal, has gone out to the Garden of Gethsemane, has spent time, probably an hour, a couple hours there praying, the soldiers have come, they've grabbed him, they've taken him to Caiaphas' house with a journey, according to John, that stopped at Annas' house on the way. Probably gave time for the guys to get all gathered out, so that's probably why they go to Annas' house. They arrive at Caiaphas' house. It's got to be well after midnight. The court could not meet at night, nor could it meet at any of the great feasts. So like Passover. Oh, that's the week of the crucifixion. When evidence was taken, witnesses were examined. Witnesses were examined separately, and their evidence to be valid must agree in every detail. You brought in a witness presented, just like in the courtroom today. You don't have witnesses all sitting in the courtroom listening to what the other witnesses say. You keep them away from one another. They come in, and if there's disagreement, you cannot find the person guilty. You can't rule against them. Each individual member of the Sanhedrin must give his verdict separately. Did you hear that in our text tonight, today? It was like an uproar. And in fact, it began with the youngest member of the Sanhedrin first. And the reason you did it with the youngest first, you did not want to have the younger to be affected by the elder members of the Sanhedrin. So you'd start with the youngest, who maybe had a mentor there in their group, but instead of them, how should I vote? No, you decide yourself. And so they'd go from youngest to oldest, one at a time. Imagine us going through them right now. Guilty or innocent. And you go one at a time. And each person, and you knew exactly, it's a name call, roll call vote, isn't it? If the verdict was a verdict of death, a night must elapse before it was carried out so that the court might have a chance to change its mind in its decision towards mercy. You had to wait a whole 24-hour period after the court ended during the day. You had to wait a whole 24-hour period, and then you could rule death. Let's see. Midnight, 9 a.m., Jesus is on the cross, 3 o'clock, he dies. Don't think they made the 24 hours, did they? The law demanded that at least two or three witnesses had to agree in order to sentence someone to death. Deuteronomy 17:6. On the testimony of two or three witnesses, a person is to be put to death. But no one is to be put to death on the testimony of just one witness. No criminal could be tried at night. No criminal could be tried through the night when it began during the day. Okay, if you start a trial during the day, you have to end in the afternoon. And in fact, no criminal could be tried in the afternoon. You couldn't start a trial in the afternoon. They're doing this in the middle of the night. Judges had to even fast through the trial, taking seriously their responsibility. Trials were never allowed on a Sabbath, never allowed on a feast day such as Passover, and not even on the day before a feast day. Oh, that's Maundy Thursday, isn't it? By Jewish law, the Sanhedrin could not initiate charges. And in fact, all trials had to be public, and all trials had to provide both a prosecution and a defense. Do you see anything wrong with the trial we've just read about today? There's just a few things I'm thinking. The interesting thing about this, verse 56, says many testified falsely against him, but their statements did not agree. If you check some of the other Gospels, it said that they were actually paying people to give false testimony. Think about that. They couldn't even pay them to come at least with an agreement on their false testimony. And there was not agreement between any of them. The closest they came was to something we'll come to in just a moment. The law, incidentally, demanded that witnesses should be summoned for every prisoner. Here, no one was called to testify for Jesus. Because if they had been called, you would have had people coming up like this. And some say, well, maybe there were people like this, but the Sanhedrin didn't listen. What would they have said if people called in favor of Jesus? Well, there might have been a leper who came up and said, I had leprosy, and I came up and he healed me. He said he wanted to touch me. He actually did, and then he healed me. I was blind, and now I can see. I was deaf, and now I can hear. I was dead, and he brought me back to life. And in fact, if you look back, one of the biggest challenges for Jesus was the fact that he raised Lazarus from the dead just a few weeks earlier. The high priest gets upset at this. Do you remember what they said he was doing wrong? Or when they finally came up with some of that, the two guys kind of agreed. He said he's going to rebuild the temple in 3 days. Well, that wasn't quite what he said. In fact, Deuteronomy 19:16 says, if a malicious witness rises against a man to accuse him of wrongdoing, then both the men who have the dispute shall stand before the Lord, before the priests and the judges, who will be in office in those days. The judges shall investigate thoroughly. And if the witness is a false witness and has accused his brother falsely, then you shall do to him as he intended to do to his brother. Thus you shall purge the evil from among you. False witnesses, what? And if they want Jesus to die, what should have happened to all these witnesses? They should have been crucified. But that's only if the Sanhedrin's going to follow the law. There's nothing to answer to the charges. They're so bad that Jesus said, why would I waste my energy in responding to these false charges? And then the high priest stood up before them and asked Jesus, are you not going to answer? What is this testimony that these men are bringing against you? But Jesus remained silent and gave no answer. Remember Isaiah 53:7? He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb led to slaughter, like a sheep is silent, so he did not open his mouth. There was no reason for Jesus to open his mouth. The testimony is false, so you don't give it any credibility by responding to it at all. Matthew 27, verse 12, when he was accused by the chief priests and the elders, he gave no answer. Then Pilate asked him, don't you hear the testimony they are bringing against you? But Jesus made no reply, not even to a single charge, to the great amazement of the governor. We'll see this in a couple of weeks when we go to the trial in front of Pilate. But they actually, instead of saying, well, he blasphemed, see, Rome's not going to kill Jesus for that. They'll come and say, well, he tried to evade taxes and he tried to start a rebellion against Rome and he's tried to set himself up as the king of the Jews and that's why you got to kill him. False testimony. So Jesus makes no reply. John 19, do you refuse to speak to me? Pilate said. Don't you realize I have power either to free you or to crucify you? Jesus answered, you would have no power over me if it were not given to you from above. Therefore, the one who handed me over to you is guilty of a greater sin. By this time in the trial, because the false witnesses aren't working, Jesus is not responding, but Caiaphas is on a mission with the rest of the Sanhedrin that is there with him. They're on a mission to kill Jesus and to get the permission to do that. And so Pilate asked this question, are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed One? So something else that's been in the news this week has been Attorney General Jeff Sessions, right? Attorney General Jeff Sessions recused himself from any investigations into the Trump campaign. This came after it was learned that he had at least two conversations, one a greeting, another a meeting in his office with some of his aides, with the Russian ambassador during the campaign. Some have been calling for Sessions to resign. Compare that to what Caiaphas said after Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead. Do you remember? When the Sanhedrin heard that Jesus had raised Lazarus from the dead, now they're really disturbed. This is before he's going to come into the temple and tear it all up, which is really going to upset them. John 11:49. Then one of them, named Caiaphas, who was high priest that year, spoke up. You know nothing at all. You do not realize that it is better for that one man die for the people than for the whole nation perish. He did not say that on his own, but as high priest that year, he prophesied that Jesus would die for the Jewish nation, and not only for that nation, but also for the scattered children of God, to bring them together and make them one. So from that day on, they plotted to take his life. Sessions recused himself. What do you think Caiaphas should have done? Few weeks before Jesus is at this trial, he's announced, one man needs to die, and it's Jesus, and we're going to get him. Jesus doesn't speak. Even as Caiaphas rips into him, Jesus doesn't respond. However, Matthew helps us to understand why Jesus will finally comment. In Matthew 26:63, but Jesus remains silent. The high priest said to him, I charge you, under oath by the living God, tell us if you are the Messiah, the Son of God. Barclay, in speaking about this passage, says he asked the very kind of question that the law completely forbade. He asked a leading question. It was forbidden to ask questions by answering which the person on trial might incriminate themselves. We even have that in our country, right? You can be on trial, and if they ask you something that would incriminate yourself, what do you say? I stand on the Fifth Amendment. Then you don't talk anymore. No man could be asked to condemn himself, but that was the very question the high priest asked. But when the high priest said, I charge you, under oath by the living God, tell us if you are the Messiah, the Son of God. Jesus, in honor of the living God, will respond. And how does he respond? Some theologians say it's no big deal. He just says, I am. But there's enough of us that believe that he was using the very name of God when he responded. How did God introduce himself to Moses? When he gave him his name, he said, I am. I am who I am. I am whom I'm becoming. I am. The name is so sacred, so holy, that Israel does not speak the name. They substitute Adonai instead, the Lord. I am, said Jesus, and you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the Mighty One and coming on the clouds of heaven. Now, even if the first part is just an I am, not using God's name, the second part of Jesus' response seals his fate in their minds of blasphemy. Because when he responds, and you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the Mighty One, he is saying, I am next to God. I am divine too. And on top of that, maybe this message, some say, was actually a message for Caiaphas. And Caiaphas, I will be coming on the clouds of heaven to judge you. I sit at the right hand of God right now, and I will come back and judge you. Jesus is actually quoting from Daniel 7:13. It's a vision that they would have known very well. In my vision at night, I looked, and there before me was one like a Son of Man coming with the clouds of heaven. He approached the Ancient of Days and was led into his presence. He was given authority, glory, and sovereign power. All nations and all peoples of every language worshipped him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion that will not pass away, and his kingdom is one that will never be destroyed. And Jesus says, that's me. You see, they knew he had already said he was the Messiah. He'd said that many times. He hadn't tried to hide that at all. To be the Messiah was actually not to be divine, but if Jesus claims to be the Messiah, then that should have required investigation, not condemnation. The ICC New Testament says the whole statement means in connection with Jesus' confession of messianic claim that they would see him exercising his messianic power. Alexander McLaren says they rightly took his words to mean more than the claim of messiahship as popularly understood. To say that he was the Christ was not blasphemy. but a claim demanding examination. But to say that he, the Son of Man, was Son of God and Supreme Judge was so according to their canons. A claim of messiahship demanded explanation. A claim of being next to God and Judge was blasphemy if it wasn't true. What does Caiaphas respond? You've heard the blasphemy! Blasphemy? Leviticus 24:16 says, the one who blasphemes the name of the Lord shall surely be put to death. Do you know how you're supposed to be put to death if you blaspheme? Taken outside the camp and stoned to death. Well, that's wrong too, isn't it? Caiaphas, at that moment, does something that the high priest is not supposed to ever do. You go back to Leviticus and you'll find in Leviticus 21 that the high priest is never to tear their garments. And what does Caiaphas do? It says he tears his garment right there. Is it his way of saying, look how bad this is, look how evil this is, look how wrong this is. And so he tears his garment, gets everyone upset. And in fact, he's already breaking another rule. Because what does he do next? What do you say, everybody? I say he votes first. I say he's guilty of blasphemy and guilty of death. The sad thing here that's probably not recognized, with the rending of his coat, the high priest is destroying the priesthood for Israel. The high priest will lose his authority as high priest. The whole priesthood itself will be destroyed. Within 40 years, the temple itself will come down, and they will no longer have a priesthood that can take care of them. Have you really observed the abuse of Jesus? They all condemned him as worthy of death. Verse 65, then some began to spit at him. They blindfolded him, struck him with their fists, and said, prophesy! And the guards took him and beat him. Another prophecy is fulfilled in that moment. Isaiah 50, verse 6, I offered my back to those who beat me, my cheeks to those who pulled out my beard. I did not hide my face from mocking and spitting. And Jesus had said this was going to happen just a few weeks earlier. In Mark 10, verse 33, we're going up to Jerusalem, he said, and the Son of Man will be delivered over to the chief priests and the teachers of the law. They will condemn him to death and will hand him over to the Gentiles, who will mock him and spit on him, flog him and kill him. And 3 days later, he will rise. Many people, and Jesus especially, is abused for doing the right thing. Jesus has just told the truth. I am. I'm the Son of God, and I'm coming back in my glory as the Judge of God. He told the truth, and yet he suffers for it. 1 Peter 2. Peter, understanding this, he's been a witness to it. He's experienced Jesus' life. He says, but how is it to your credit if you receive a beating for doing wrong and endure it? But if you suffer for doing good and you endure it, this is commendable before God. To this you were called, because Christ suffered for you, leaving you an example that you should follow in his steps. He committed no sin, no deceit was found in his mouth. When they hurled their insults at him, he did not retaliate. When he suffered, he made no threats. Instead, he entrusted himself to him who judges justly. Most of us know this story and have watched it and read about it for years. But as we look at this story today, I think we need to ask ourselves a question. Do we abuse Jesus? You and I. Do we abuse Jesus? Surely we wouldn't spit in his face or beat him, put something over his head and so he couldn't see, and smack him like this. You have to notice that, right? When it says that they were slapping him, this is such deep ridicule to slap a person in the face like that. They're slapping him. How nasty. Spitting in his face. Punching him. By the time Jesus gets to the place where he'll be whipped by the Romans, he's probably already disfigured by the bruising. I wonder, are we as clear with our declaration about Jesus Christ as Jesus Christ is about himself? So many of us profess belief in Jesus, a recognition of him, but do we really honor him as he deserves? May I ask it a little bit more difficultly for you? Not only do we abuse God, but do we blaspheme God? Jesus is being accused of blasphemy. What is blasphemy? Well, it's an anglicized word for the Greek term blasphemia, which scholars believe probably derives from two roots, blapto, to injure, and feme, to speak. The word would thus suggest injurious speech. Romans 2:24 says, as it is written, God's name is blasphemed among the Gentiles because of you. It's an interesting verse because Paul is saying that people are speaking injuriously, speaking bad, speaking negatively about God because of the church. And if you cause somebody else to blaspheme, guess what, folks? Then you are guilty of blasphemy. If the church is speaking about God and acting in such a way that people are getting angry, being hate-filled towards God because of what we are saying, we are guilty of blasphemy. When the people of the world observe those who profess to be saints living immorally, they frequently speak injuriously against the Lord himself. Some God he must be if his children live like that. People are watching us to see what the church will be like, to see, do we believe in Jesus? They watch to see what that means to us. Our actions can actually cause others to blaspheme God. And when people do that, when people blaspheme God because of our actions, we're guilty. Isaiah 52. Now what do I have here, declares the Lord? For my people have been taken away for nothing, and those who rule them mock, declares the Lord. And all day long my name is constantly blasphemed. Therefore my people will know my name. Therefore in that day they will know that it is I who foretold. Yet it is I. How beautiful in the mountains are the feet of those who bring good news, who proclaim peace, who bring good tidings, who proclaim salvation, who say to Zion, your God reigns. We can either blaspheme God, or we can have the beautiful feet that proclaim the good news of God. Ezekiel 36, and wherever they went among the nations, they profaned my holy name. For it was said of them, these are the Lord's people, and yet they had to leave his land. I had concern for my holy name, which the people of Israel profaned among the nations where they had gone. Therefore say to the Israelites, this is what the sovereign Lord says, it is not for your sake, people of Israel, that I am going to do these things, but for the sake of my holy name, which you have profaned among the nations where you have gone. So what of us? What of us? Do we blaspheme God himself by our actions that the world looks at and says, I don't want anything to do with your God? Father, none of us would want to stand in front of Jesus and slap him in the face, spit in his face, punch him, ridicule him, criticize him. None of us would have wanted to have been a part of that unholy, horrible, false trial that was illegal in every way except that it accomplished what you had set out for, that Jesus would die on the cross. Innocent, paying the price for our sins. And while we would never want to be found cursing him, spitting at him, beating him, there are ways, Lord, that we have to admit that we harm the truth of Jesus Christ. It may be just in little ways that we talk negatively about the church or about the pastor or the people, somebody there, the gossip, the criticism that we may have about anything, the music, the chairs, the lighting. There's so many ways, God, that we can become negative and critical. And in so doing, right here maybe on a Sunday afternoon, point people away from Jesus. Forgive us, God. Lord, you even said that we have a responsibility to love one another. It goes right along with the commandment to love the Lord your God with all their heart, mind, soul, and strength. You've said that we have a responsibility to love each other. And that even today now as we prepare to take communion, Lord, you warned that if we're not right with our brother or our sister, we should not receive communion. And that when we do it in an unholy way. Isn't that a form of blasphemy? You've told us to forgive, and we may still hold something against someone else. You've told us to make things right, whether we've been the one harmed or whether we did the harming. You've said, make things right. God, I would dare say that walking in here today, there's not a single person who would say, oh yeah, I blaspheme God. Jesus, you are coming someday to judge. When we stand in judgment of others, when we criticize and critique and hold things against other people, when we get nasty and negative and angry and curse, and Lord, it seems like we're guilty of blasphemy. So God, convict us. We don't want to take this event lightly. We surely don't want to follow the example of the Sanhedrin. Forgive us, cleanse us, point the way. So that instead of blaspheming or causing others to speak negatively of you, they will see us as feet shod with the gospel of peace, bringing good news to the poor. In Jesus' name.